Welcome to God's Church on this, the 11th Sunday after Pentecost. Our communities of faith have one great aim and purpose, and that is to help people grow in life-giving relationships with their neighbors, with their own selves, with the earth, and with God. That's why we have come together, and that's why we're glad that you've joined us today. I'm Pastor Paul from Blair Lutheran Church, and this is...
I'm Pastor Adam at North Beaver Creek Lutheran Church. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the unity of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Joyful, joyful, we adore.
us pray. Holy God, let us take a moment to be with you, to breathe gently, to be mindful of your presence. As we are still, we ponder what is bent over in us. What are we captive to? What holds us in bondage? Is it fear? Is it loss? Is it habits that hold us? Ways of thinking that cripple us? Jesus looks at us, truly seeing us, all of us, the good and the broken and the bent parts of us. He calls us, "You are mine," he says. Help us imagine that he is laying his hands on us, his power flowing through us, his light filling us, touching, healing those parts of us that are bent and broken, so we can rise, straighten, and stand tall. What unseen gifts, what unacknowledged beauty, what hidden strength can now be released? We are all sons and daughters of Abraham, your children. Free us and make us whole. Amen. Our first reading for today comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58. And the prophet Isaiah here is quoting what God has told him. "Do you think this is the kind of fast day I'm after, a day to show off humility, to put on a pious long face and parade around solemnly in black? Do you call that fasting, a fast day that I, God, would like? This is the kind of fast day I'm after, to break the chains of injustice, to get rid of exploitation in the workplace, to free the oppressed, to cancel debts. What I'm interested in seeing you do is this: share your food with the hungry, invite the homeless poor into your homes, put clothes on the shivering, ill-clad, be available to your own families. Do this, and the lights will turn on, and your lives will turn around at once. Your righteousness will pave your way. The God of glory will secure your passage. And then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help, and I'll say, 'Here I am, a full life in the emptiest of places.' If you get rid of unfair practices, if you quit blaming victims, if you quit gossiping about other people's sins, if you are generous with the hungry and start giving yourselves to the down and out, your lives will begin to glow in the darkness. Your shadowed lives will be bathed in sunlight. I will always show you where to go. I'll give you a full life in the emptiest of places, firm muscles, strong bones. You'll be like a well-watered garden, a gurgling spring that never runs dry. You'll use the old rubble of the past lives to build anew, to rebuild foundations from out of your past. You'll be known as those who can fix anything. Restore old ruins, rebuild and renovate, make the community livable again. If you watch your step on the Sabbath and don't use my holy day for personal advantage, if you treat the Sabbath as a day of joy, God's holy day as a celebration, if you honor it by refusing business as usual, making money, running here and there, then you will be free to enjoy God. Oh, I'll make you ride high and soar above it all. I'll make you feast on the inheritance of your ancestor Jacob." Yeah, God says so. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Our psalm today is from Psalm 103. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all God's benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the grave and crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's. O Lord, you provide vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. You made known your ways to Moses and your works to the children of Israel. Lord, you are full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Our gospel for today comes from Luke, the 13th chapter. Now Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and quite unable to stand up straight. And when Jesus saw her, he called her and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, but not on the Sabbath day." The Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" And when he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. This is the gospel of the Lord. Holy God, give us grace and open our hearts and minds to hear your true and living word, Jesus the Christ, who will transform our lives. Amen. In the book, The Great Divorce, by C.S. Lewis, there's a busload of people who leave hell for a holiday in heaven. And when they arrive in heaven, they land by a beautiful river surrounded by grass and trees, but they find themselves being mere shadows, and they have no weight. So even walking on the grass, because it doesn't give, it's painful. And even lifting a leaf is too heavy. Spirits come and urge them to repent, to change their minds, and to travel toward the distant mountains. And during that journey there, they will become more solid and feel less discomfort, and they'll be able to stay in heaven. As it turns out, almost all of the people choose to return to hell because they refuse to change their mind. One of them distrusts everyone and everything. Another won't let go of his need for fame and personal property. Another hates himself. Another is consumed by pious pettiness and fussiness about other people's behaviors. And yet another manipulates others to do their bidding. And yet another refuses to give up pining for the child that she lost, though even by doing so, she would be able to see him again in heaven. You know, they refuse to let go of their hatreds, their egos, their self-righteous and self-superior attitudes, and just surrender to the love of God. In our gospel story today, it's the Pharisees, the temple leaders, that refuse to let go of their pious pettiness and just be glad for the woman who was healed by Jesus. They're in bondage to their self-righteousness and their self-superiority. Well, they know the law best. And according to Jewish law and practice, healing was considered work and not to be done on the day of rest. The leader of the synagogue was reiterating the letter of the law. No work on the Sabbath. But Jesus was saying that the spirit of the law allowed for the setting free of animals for their well-being, so setting this woman free for her well-being was at least as important as that. There's always a tension between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. Isaiah, in our reading today, was saying that ritual fasting was fine, but it needs to be accompanied by real direct action. Otherwise, it was hypocritical. Jesus was saying that the prohibition of work on the Sabbath was fine, but it needs to be tempered by compassion. The Pharisees were reading their law literally in order to maintain their place of authority and control over the people. And in many ways, this is Jesus telling us that reading scriptures literally is not adequate or even legitimate. And there are a number of denominations that choose to read scripture that way, but here Jesus, like Isaiah before him, is saying that reading scripture only literally is at least incomplete, if not downright fraud. Isaiah was berating the people who made a public show of their fasting to show how pious they were. He relates what God is saying. "This is the kind of fast day that I'm after," says God, "to break the chains of injustice, to get rid of the exploitation in the workplace, to free the oppressed, to cancel debts. What I'm interested in seeing you do is sharing your food with the hungry, inviting the homeless poor into your homes, putting clothes on the shivering, ill-clad, and being available to your own families." The prophet Isaiah is not opposed to ritual fasting. He's opposed to false piety, to religious fraudulence. And he's saying, if you really want to correct your wrongdoings, to be sorry for your sins, you better be out there doing the things you should be doing, feeding the hungry, taking in the poor, clothing the naked, and so on. The prophet here offers a kind of test. If our fasting, if our religious observances come coupled with a passion for justice and a heart of kindness, then we've got some integrity. If, however, we think that because we do the right things and we have the right rituals, you know, go to church on Sundays, throw a dollar in the plate, maybe sit on a committee occasionally, then God will reward us because we're better than others. Except that then our religious lives are a scam. Jesus provides us with one example of how we are to go about using scripture in a way that harmonizes with God's overall intent. Jesus is asking us to look at how we obey the law through the eyes of God. God, who is compassionate beyond measure, who loves each of his children no matter how broken they are. God, who reminds us that we are all kin, that each person is our brother or sister. Jesus' invitation is to live life with God, to change our minds from loving only those we want to love to loving those whom God loves, to seek justice not just for the people like us, but for all people, and to remember that the vulnerable ones, the ones who express their pains in ways we may not like, are still fundamentally our family. Martin Luther's Small Catechism treats each commandment not as a rule to be followed, but as a different way of seeing the world and acting in that world that is harmonious with God's intent. Here's one. "Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. We are to fear and love God so that we do not despise preaching or God's word, but instead keep that word holy and gladly hear it and learn it regularly. Do not kill," another commandment, which means we are to fear and love God so that we neither endanger nor harm the lives of our neighbors, but instead help and support them in all of life's needs. And the big one here, do not bear false witness. We are to fear and love God so that we do not tell lies about our neighbors, betray or slander them, or destroy their reputations. Instead, we are to come to their defense, to speak well of them, and interpret everything they do in the best possible light. And who is our neighbor? Everyone. Seeing the world the way God sees it, acting in the way that honors God and all of God's children. When we want to atone for our sins, when we want to correct our wrongdoings, we need to look at the spirit of the law. So how does this story apply to us today? Well, first, being good does not just mean adhering to the law or following the rules. The synagogue leader takes his laws literally and seriously, but Jesus contends that beneath the surface of the laws lays a deeper intent, the welfare of those who are in need. So if keeping the law gets in the way of caring for someone in need, you break the law to fulfill it. History gives us many examples of this. The people like Oskar Schindler, who broke the law to save Jews from the Nazis. People like Martin Luther King Jr., who broke laws to advance the idea of equal treatment for all, regardless of skin color. To today, where people are being arrested for bringing food and water to refugees or people on the voting lines. Jesus is all about releasing people from bondage and captivity. Did you catch Jesus' words? You are set free from your ailment. Which then should lead us to question, what are we in bondage to? What holds us captive? What keeps us on that bus to hell? Fear. Fear is a big one. Fear of failure, fear of looking foolish, fear of what will people think about us, fear of the world. And then how about ways of thinking that hold us captive? I'm not good enough. No one can love me as I am. They don't deserve that. And, my way is the right way. There's some captive thinking going on there. What keeps us from seeing the world the way God sees it? Is it the need to feel superior to someone rather than compassion for them? Is it the need to exercise our rights at somebody else's expense? Is it the need to put someone down because we just don't feel that good about ourselves? Lots of things keep us from speaking well of others and from helping and supporting others in need and from gladly hearing God's word and learning it. There's something very basic here in this story about Jesus' approach to the world, which should be our approach. Jesus does not judge the bent over woman. He does not indicate that she has great faith. There's nothing to indicate that she even asked for healing. Jesus simply sees her predicament, and his heart goes out to her. He gives her what she needs regardless of the law. Jesus, God, has concern for our human situations, the challenges, the difficulties that we all face. Jesus sees a person to be loved and cherished, not just some bent-over woman. Jesus sees a fellow child of God and says, "Fear not. I am with you. Do not be dismayed. I'll strengthen you, help you, cause you to stand." The church should be a place of healing and hope. Too often, it's a place of division and strife. We should surrender our hatreds, our egos, our self-righteous and self-superior attitudes, and focus our attention on the needs of the people of our community so that we can be that place of healing and hope, a place where compassion is valued more highly than piety, where we attend to the spirit of the law and are less concerned about the letter of it, where our commitment to God is evidenced by reaching out to all of our brothers and sisters who are captive to fear or to self-defeating ways of thinking, or who have been crippled by our ignorance of the spirit of the law. Amen. Let's join now in professing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer.
Lord, listen to your children. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Holy One, you crown your church with steadfast love and mercy. Guide us continually, as we promised in our baptism, to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Use our diverse gifts in service to the whole people of God. You satisfy the needs of all creatures. May we protect the habitats of fish and birds and repair ecosystems that have been damaged by misuse, neglect, or natural disasters, so that all creation may thrive.
Lord, Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Inspire us. Inspire our leaders and rulers with your compassion and your mercy. Raise up activists and community organizers to restore places that have been affected by violence, poverty, and inequality. You provide justice for all who are oppressed and relief to all who are afflicted. Heal those who are bent over by addiction or depression or anxiety. Set free all who cry out from under the weight of grief or mental, emotional, or physical distress.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Lord, you call us to delight in the Sabbath. Renew our bodies, our minds, and our spirits in this worshiping assembly. Generations, bless your holy name. We give you thanks for the communion of saints who have gathered in prayer and praise in this place. Support us in your love until we rest forever in you. Receive these prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus the Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's go ahead and share a peace, word of peace with each other. We'll now collect our tithes and offerings. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field, to equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by the glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the choirs of angels, the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, let's praise their name and join their unending hymn.
Oh,
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks, and he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so together, as the body of Christ, we proclaim the mystery of faith until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us that this meal may be a communion in the body and blood of our Lord. Make us one with Christ and with all who share this feast. Unite us in faith. Encourage us with hope. Inspire us to love so that we might feed the world. And now as we are gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Christ's presence, there is fullness of joy. Come to the banquet. Let us become what we receive.
Yeah.
life-giving God. Through this meal, you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that we may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now may the Eucharist be a fire that inflames you. May we depart from this altar breathing fire, ready to take on the evils of this world and grace, with grace and peace and love. May your life be a brush in the very hand of God, painting new creation into every nook and cranny that your shadow graces. Be courageous, be free, prune that which needs pruning, and water that which thirsts for righteousness. You are the body of Christ, the light of the world. So pick up your hammer, your brush, your skillet, your pen. Pick up your head and walk, run, dance, fly. The great artist has called you into being. So go into your world, your valley, or your garden, and create with his grace and in his peace. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve your neighbor. Thanks be to God.